Hey everybody, it's Chugga Conroy. Welcome back to more Xenoblade Chronicles. Last time, we finished our climb up Mykonos, reaching the transporter to Agnirotha, the capital which Egil wishes to restore to its former glory. This time, as we emerge from the transporter, let's see just what happened to this place.
So this is the Mykonos capital?
Yes, Agnirotha. The heart of the Machina civilization.
It looks so desolate. Like there are no signs of anyone living here.
It truly is a soulless city.
Here, bad place. Ricky want to go.
So the Machina built this whole city. Not too shabby.
It looks like the buildings have been here for a very long time.
Look, Shulk! Dino Beast! Dino Beast eat city!
A Dino Beast? Here?
But how?
It is a Telethia! It looks like it's stone. Why would there be a Telethia in a place like this? The fossilized Telethia are what remain of the beasts that attacked the capital in the ancient battle.
Why did the Telethia attack your city? Wasn't the ancient battle only between the Bionis and the Mykonos themselves?
The answer to your question can be found in that tower, the data center. It is better that you see with your own eyes. Only then will you truly understand what happened between the Bionis and the Mykonos.
Many questions will be answered here today about the two Titans and what happened to this city. As we look at the ruined city before us, you can see that there are some windows to the outside. That is because Agnirotha is located inside the face of the Mykonos. Those are the grates that you could see on the face of the Mykonos ever since we crawled out onto the leg for the first time. Those towers that were hanging down out of the face are the buildings of Agnirotha as well. Think about just how far away that looked when we crawled out under the leg. That is how far we have come. As we reach the central tower, instead of going into the data center right away, I want to go over here because there's an ether crystal deposit. If we try to grab it, however, we get invisible walled that doesn't really seem to want us going over here. It's strange because it's usually so big in exploration, but I guess this place is an exception. Once we go into the data center, you can see that in here it is side quest central. All of these monitors have quests for you, and the map doesn't really seem to like that as... well, all of those exclamation marks are kind of phasing through each other and glitching out. But I don't want to accept any of these right now. What I want to do instead is check the shop terminal. If you notice, it resembles the affinity symbol for Mykonos itself. A little interesting there, so how about we update our equipment? Also, maybe with this shop I'll finally be able to get Ryan something other than that stupid jungle equipment. I mean, normally I like it, but he just sticks out like a sore thumb compared to all that other high-tech armor everyone else has gotten, but... it really has been the best armor for him for, like, the longest time. On the weapons tab, we have one slot variants of all the Machina 2 weapons, but if you were fighting enemies in, like, any capacity back in the central factory, odds are you have two or even three slot variants of these weapons already and don't need to buy them. I skip a lot of battles for you guys, and honestly, even I don't need to buy these things. Fiora's got the Karma Blades, which up critical hits and give her a slot, but I don't really think I need that. Interestingly enough, Sharla has a Machina cannon here rather than just like a Machina rifle too or something like that. I already have one of these as well. As you can see, I have two of them, in fact, already. On every tab, we have the Orion and Taurus series for heavy armor, but as I've said, I'm not really that big of a fan of heavy armor, so I will not be getting these, especially seeing as they are zero slot variants of them. But aside from the heavy armor, Fiora has four sets of Mykonos equipment that you can choose from. We have the Speed series, which gives her Aggro down 5, Haste 5, Agility up 5, and another Agility up 5, actually. Ether series gives Debuff Resist 4, Attack plus 5, I don't think I've mentioned it before, but Attack plus increases the maximum auto attack damage that a weapon can do, It would be good, but there's a bit of a bug involving it that I plan to go over at a later point. I've alluded to this before, but I do still plan to go over it. Ether up 5, as you would expect Ether equipment to do. And another Ether up 5, of course. Attack series gives arts heal 5, that'll make it so that you recover 50 HP every time you use an art. Attack stability 5, this increases the minimum auto attack damage that a weapon can do. It's better than the attack plus gem in that this one isn't bugged, it's the maximum damage that's bugged. Again, I'll be going over this later. Strength up 5, and of course, another strength up 5. Then for power, you got aggro up 5. Damage heal 5, this makes so that you will recover 100 HP 25% of the time that you take damage. Good footing 5 makes it so that you will not be blown away by an attack that would have done it 50% of the time. So this is mainly for the sponge tank if you want to have them always online and just never really toppled or getting blown away, unable to keep drawing the aggro. I don't personally use her for that, but she definitely is good at doing it. In the foot equipment for Fiora, we have the Hellwareth drones, I hope I said that right. I may or may not know how to pronounce that properly. That will give you sword drones 1, so by equipping that she will get a new talent art. Of course I want to buy these so I can show it off. The Ishtar drones give shield drones 1, which is yet another new art, so of course I want to grab that. And the ukulele drones, that gives cannon drones 2, which we have seen already, so no need to get that. Due to being low in inventory space, as we saw back in the central factory, grumble, grumble, I'm opting to just sell all of my rank 2 gems because, quite frankly, nobody is ever going to equip these ever again. Or rather, Shulk is currently using a critical up 2 gem. Well, I feel kinda silly now. I'm also just gonna sell my last page of generic materials. None of these have quest markers on them, none of them are needed at Colony 6. A lot of these we got as early as, like, Sartorial Marsh, so I really just don't think I need to hang on to these anymore. With everything done at the store, since we are updating our equipment anyway, I think I want to do some gem crafting for a little bit. Again, you will see my updated equipment and gems at the end of this video if you want to see that. But yes, I am going to be crafting because we are really low on inventory space and I desperately need it. Gonna let you know straight up, you are going to want lock-on resist gems coming up. I'm not going to equip any right now, but if you have the crystals for it, you might as well craft them because trust me, these are going to come in really, really handy in the near future. I feel like an idiot. I'm going to be showing all the updated equipment at the end of the video, of course, but I want to specifically go over Fiora because I have changed a lot with her. I gave her 2 double attack 5 gems that I got from gem crafting, so her double attack chance is maxed out at its base of 50%. It also stacks with her speed shift, so that is really, really nice. I gave her aggro down 5 because she is going to be attacking like nuts now, and I really don't want her to, like, have to worry about having the aggro too much. She also no longer has any agility gems, so she won't really be tanking much. The haste 5 gem makes so she'll be auto-attacking more frequently in addition to all those double attacks. And then I gave her 2 ether equipment pieces that each have an ether up 5 gem on them. I kind of want to go for a mixture of physical and ether arts, so that way she's auto-attacking like nuts and she can do some really nice ether attacks as well. I gave her the Hellworthia drones, so she's going to have the sword drones first as her talent art next time we fight. And quite frankly, the sword drones are absolutely incredible, which is why I put such a big emphasis on auto-attacking. In addition to that, to accommodate for her new stats, I have switched out some of her arts. This is why I wanted to go into her specifically. I got rid of Power Drain for Ether Drain. This will inflict Ether down on all enemies in the area and give her Ether up. I also gave her Zero Gravity because that can fill the talent gauge by 25%, and I really, really want that talent gauge. Now, I know I've gone over these arts already, I just kind of wanted to mention as a bit of a refresher. Zero Gravity, I think, is one of her better damaging arts, so of course I think I want to level that up a little bit. She's actually gotten a lot of AP since we last played as her. I'm going to go for the Ether Drain, and as you see there, I also got rid of Cross Impact for Magstorm. I don't recommend leveling up Magstorm that much. The reason being is that it only inflicts daze on Mechon, and while the damage is good, and I suppose you might want it for drawing lots of aggro, I just didn't really want it on her because, well, you're not always fighting Mechon, quite frankly, and it's kind of a shame that the bonus effect of that just kind of depends on that. With that done, we are now fully equipped for the road ahead. We don't have much more to go until we reach Egil, so let's go into this lift and find out exactly what happened between the two titans all those years ago. I'm just saying this because this will probably be the last that you hear from me in this video. As we're going up, without spoiling what's going to happen, just because I want to get some of my opinions out there, I do want to say that Agnirithe has one of the deepest emotional connections I've ever felt to a location in a fictional world. While there are more reasons for this than what we'll see here today, its backstory definitely plays a part in this. Let's find out the histories of Bionis and Mechonis that have been lost from the world for hundreds of years.
It looks like the power's up and running.
Fiora, what's the matter? Everyone, follow me.
What is that?
It looks like it's here. But it's just an image.
No way.
Whoa! You're right!
These are memories of a time long forgotten.
Fiora!
Hey.
They were left behind by the Machina before they abandoned this place, so that others may know their story.
Her voice sounds like...
In ancient times, when the Bionis and the Mechonis came into existence, I was born as well. Just as the Bionis had a soul, I came to exist in this world. As the soul of the Mechonis. I created my children on Mechonis, and acquired this body. They called themselves Machina. And Mechonis was transformed into a world brimming with life. The Machina gave rise to an advanced civilization, and built this great city.
This city?
I can't believe it used to be so lively.
They lived their lives in peace and harmony. The gentle Machina worshipped me. Life also flourished on Bionis. The Machina generously shared the fruits of their civilization with the peoples of the Bionis. They believed their two worlds would grow hand in hand. Then, a terrible fate descended on them from above.
The Bionis?
Wielding the Sword of Light, the Bionis attempted to destroy the Machina.
Are those Telethia?
I tried to save the Machina, and confronted the Bionis. And so, I confronted Zanza.
Zanza?
The battle waged on and on. Even as our life forces depleted, Zanza and I continued to fight. However, it did at last come to an end.
Giant.
This is when Zanza was imprisoned.
Taking advantage of my final blow to the Bionis, its beings took Zanza and sealed him firmly away. However, the battle with Zanza had greatly consumed my life force. I warned the surviving Machina that the Bionis had not yet been destroyed, and that one day, he would be released.
I'm the one who released him.
I then entered a long and deep slumber, in preparation for Zanza's inevitable reawakening.
It's all clear to me what you wanted to do. Stop the battle between the Bionis and the Machonis.
Fiora, I see now. It was her inside you.
Yes. Lady Maenith desired a body in which she could be free. And after you were captured by Egil's Mekon, it was I who transferred her soul into your body.
But why did it have to be my body?
Because you are close to Shulk, the heir to the Monado.
It was all because of our world, because of Bionis, that this city was devastated.
Now I understand why Egil would want to stop the Bionis from reawakening.
I get it too. But how's killing any of us gonna solve his problem?
Precisely. What happened to the Machina was a tragedy. But we cannot forgive the Mekon attack on Bionis.
What worries me is the Monado that the Bionis used. It's no different from how the legends describe, but still.
It must hold a deadly power.
But you have used it wisely, Shulk. It has not overwhelmed you, as it did me.
He's right. If you hadn't been using the Monado, we wouldn't have lasted 5 minutes.
But it was Zanza who bestowed this sword upon me.
However, it is not Zanza who now wields the Monado. It is you, Shulk. That is also the reason why Maenith chose Fiora as a vessel, so that the tragedy of he who wields the Monado would not be repeated.
The tragedy of he who wields the Monado?
Shulk, believe. Believe in the path you have chosen, and those who walk it with you. Maenith once said this of the Monado. The Monado is not simply a unique weapon. It is the light within each and every person in this world.
Light? What do you mean?
It is the light of life. The will to survive no matter what. Perhaps Lady Maenith was drawn to your light. Beyond there lies the Maenith Shrine. Egil will be there. Is it still your intention to defeat Egil? That has not changed.
We understand the history of Mekonis now. If he is willing to listen, we will try to reason with him. But if not...
I understand. Then, if that is your decision, so be it. I will try to persuade Egil one last time. But I am prepared for his refusal. Venea.